My name is Mukul Chadda, and it's an absolute privilege of mine to welcome you to the second Unifi Innovation Lecture. These lectures are designed to help us learn more about the future, which I'm sure is something we all want to know much more about. Tonight's discussion has an interesting ring to it: clean disruption. And we're delighted to have with us Mr. Tony Seba, author, thought leader, serial entrepreneur, advisor, and Stanford University instructor, to share his expertise with us on this topic. Thank you very much, sir. That this event is in memory of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, a man of great foresight and vision for the country. And may I ask all of you, as a mark of respect, to stand for the national anthem. I'd like to invite Mr. Sharad Reddy, founder Unifi, to make a few opening remarks.
George Bernard Shaw was a famous Irish playwright. He won the Nobel Prize in 1925. He was gifted with being able to say things in a way that one couldn't forget. One of the things that hasn't been forgotten is his view on what he called the unreasonable man. I'd like to quote him. "The reasonable man adapts himself to the world. The unreasonable one persists in trying to adapt the world to himself. Therefore, all progress depends on the unreasonable man." Dr. Kalam was a very unreasonable man. Paris Protocol that the Indian government signed in 2015 is a landmark commitment that India has made. If you look back at the Second World War, they say 60 million people lost their lives. That's around 3% of the population at that time. If you look forward at the next 10 to 20 years and ask yourself about the changes that will be faster upon us than we, I think, understand, the changes from climate change, can you imagine the implication on the millions of people who live on coastlines in India, in countries like Bangladesh, which are low-lying, in countries along the coastlines of Africa and Latin America who don't have the budgets to do anything about relocating millions of people onto higher ground, creating for them opportunities for a new livelihood, new homes? The implications of that on our social order, on peace that we take for granted. And when you think about that, and when you think about the need for technology to address the commitment India made just 9 months ago. There are people in this room who you will meet over dinner who are at the forefront of, for example, solar, who will tell us that we now have the ability to do it. Our commitment to you is that when you leave this room, you leave with more than you came in here. Learn about things that over the next 10 years will play a dramatic impact on our lives. We, as much as all of you, want to learn from people like him to be able to put into our portfolios positions that are equipped for the future. We need to future-proof our investments, and we're as keen to pick up from you, Tony. Thank you for accepting our invitation. It's the first time Tony is here. Before I hand it over to him, and I quote, "If you want to leave your footprints in the sands of time, don't drag your feet."
I'd like to call the very affable Mr. Ravi Jethani to come up to segue us into the star attraction of the evening.
So this gentleman called Tony Seba has written loads of books. Some of the noticeable ones are Clean Disruption of Energy and Transportation, Solar Trillions, Winner Takes All, 9 Rules of High-Tech Strategy. He is a Stanford graduate. He also is an ongoing instructor at Stanford. He's also, very importantly, an advisor to loads of policymakers, corporations, as well as investors like us in the room. So without taking any more time, may I please request Mr. Tony Seba to come and join us at the stage.
Thank you so much for your kind introduction, and thanks so much for being here. So I want to take you into the future. Into the future of energy and transportation and more. But before I do that, I want to take you a little bit into the past. Who's been to New York lately? New York? Yeah. Yeah, see, New Yorkers always sit up front for some reason. So I want to take you into the past, New York City, 1900. Can anyone, okay, so I pointed that. For thousands of years, we used horses as the main means of human transportation. And 1900, New York City, Fifth Avenue, can anyone in a sea of horses see the one car in that picture? The one car, and I already pointed at it, that's the car. That's the one car when, if somebody had said, somebody really unreasonable had said that in a few years, cars are going to disrupt horses, people would have said, you're crazy, right? But, you know, 13 years later, can anyone point to the one horse in that picture? Same place, New York City, same Fifth Avenue. There is one horse in this picture, all cars. New York went from all horse to all cars in 13 years. That's all it took. The main means of transportation of humanity for thousands of years. And that was a technology-based disruption. And the technology of the time was called the internal combustion engine automobile, ICE car, gasoline car or diesel car. And so what is a disruption? A disruption, and I want to explain, because you ask 100 people and you get 101 answers as to what disruption is. And my work is technology-based disruption. It's when something, a convergence of technologies, make it possible for entrepreneurs and companies to create new products and services that do two things. One is they create new markets. So think Uber, think Ola. They're creating new markets. And at the same time, they destroy or radically transform an existing industry. So again, think Ola or Uber, and they're radically transforming the taxi, the transportation industry. Now, if you think of digital cameras versus film cameras, those of you who know what a film camera is, essentially digital destroyed, totally destroyed, the film camera industry. So these two types are both different types of disruption. And this is what's interesting about disruption. It's usually the experts and the insiders, really smart people, who deny and dismiss the disruptive possibilities. They'll say, no, you know, it's not going to happen. It can't possibly happen this quickly. And it's really smart people, like Bill Gates, who said just before the web took off, yeah, you know, this internet thing, it only has a few users. And that was 1994, before it took off. And Microsoft, of course, got disrupted by the Googles and the Facebooks and the Amazons and the Alibabas of the world. So my work is, in many ways, to answer this question. Why do smart people in smart organizations constantly fail to anticipate, let alone lead, market disruptions? Because if you can anticipate it, you can lead it. But before I answer that question, and I'm going to get back to that, I want to talk a little bit about why energy is so important. So I'll tell you about the disruption of energy in a few minutes. But why energy? I mean, why am I in energy? Why is Unifi Capital so interested in energy? So I want to give you a broad picture of why energy is important. And energy is, in the opinion of many, the single most important issue that basically the Earth faces today. And energy is central to a whole host of things that we may not think about. Water, food, poverty, health, geopolitics, war, terrorism, the economy, all of these things are dependent on energy. And so energy really is a very, very strategic industry, not just strategic, it's very, very large, and I'll get back to that. So economy, energy is an $8 trillion industry, eight. If we spend more in energy, we the world, than we do food, clothing, information technology. I mean, energy is larger than all of these industries. How large is energy? If energy stand, we're a country, it would be the third largest economy in the world. It would be almost four times larger than India. It would be larger than Germany and Japan. So that's how large the energy industry is. Really, really large. If the US oil and gas industry were a state, it would be, you know, one of the largest states in the nation, the fifth largest state in the nation. That's how large it would be. Energy and the economy. Every single recession that we have faced, we, the US, over the last few decades, has been preceded by a spike in oil prices. Isn't that interesting? So the economy is very, very tied to energy. Energy and water. It takes 2,500 liters of water to produce one single liter of ethanol from sugarcane. So those who say that agricultural biofuels are a solution to the energy problem, think about water. You know, because biofuels are contributing to water shortages. Again, sugarcane is not the biggest consumer of water. If you think about jatropha, it takes about 19,000 liters of water to produce a single liter of biodiesel. In what universe is this sustainable? Talk about water shortages, right? So to put this in context, a single bus that is filled with biodiesel from soybean would essentially take as much water as a swimming pool, an Olympic-sized swimming pool. Now, how many buses does Mumbai alone have, right? I mean, think about each day, they would be using the water equivalent of an Olympic-sized swimming pool. A lot of people don't make these connections, and that's why energy is so important and so interesting. If we powered the whole United States with solar or wind, it would use the water equivalent of a single fracked natural gas well, a single one. And we have 500,000 of them. So the choices that you make in energy basically have consequences in water and, of course, food. How? If you think about, again, biofuels, they have become about half of all new crops in the US, in Europe, in a lot of countries. And that has an implication, if you look at the both curves, in food prices. They will deny it, but there's the evidence. Energy and poverty. What's the connection? Well, 1.5 billion people around the world have no access to electricity. In India, 500,000 people, 500,000 people in 500,000 villages have no access to the grid. And when you have no access to power, you have no power, right? When you have no access to electric power, you have no access to the internet, you don't have access to information, you don't have access to education. Essentially, economically, it stunts the economic and social growth of that population. Energy and the environment. There, of course, now you read any newspaper, all I've read since I came here on the cover of every newspaper is the disaster in Delhi, right? The air quality, how awful it is. So energy and the environment, greenhouse gases. essentially come from three fossil fuels. Most greenhouse gases come from oil, gas, and coal, period. Okay? And climate change, of course, is probably the most important issue of millennials. I mean, you know, this is the single most important issue that you're going to face, those millennials in the crowd. And this is, of course, why I got invited to stand here before you, because Unifi has been doing a lot of work in how climate has been changing, how it's impacting the economy in India, what the opportunities are, and so on and so forth. And that's how they came across my work, and that's why I'm here. Energy and the environment, something that a lot of people don't talk about is ocean acidification. And ocean acidification has been called the evil twin of climate change. Why? Because oceans absorb half of all CO2. So it's not, climate is not just, you know, the atmosphere, it's also the oceans. And what happens to oceans is that they become acidic. And they have become about 30% more acidic. And I don't know if you remember your chemistry classes from high school, but when something becomes more acidic, essentially a lot of life can't basically grow. Bones start dissolving. Plankton, which is the basis for all food in the ocean, can't live in acidic waters. And so this is a huge issue also that's parallel to climate change. Health. Need I tell you about health? Basically, coal pollution kills 70,000 Indians per year. Coal, that's, you know, and it's getting worse. In India, indoor, not outdoor, but indoor air pollution kills 300,000 to 400,000 Indians per year. That's indoor. You can't go out because fossil fuels are killing you, and you can't stay inside because fossil fuels are killing you. You know, it's like you can't get away from fossil fuels. And 13 of the world's top or bottom 20 most polluted cities are in India. 13, right? According to the World Health Organization. And that, of course, outdoor air pollution kills 500,000 plus Indians per year. Wow, I'm already getting depressed. I want to go home, right? I mean, this is a disaster. And it's not just, it's costing India 3% of GDP or more. It's costing India $40 billion per year, which is just about 3% of GDP. So is this an energy crisis, or is energy equal to crisis, right? I mean, it's like, you know, and of course, I don't need to remind you of the 2012 blackouts that left most of India without power, the part of India that does have power, right? And the fact that 7 million people worldwide are killed by fossil fuel, indoor and outdoor air pollution. So it's not just an India problem, it's a worldwide problem. 7 million people, right? And who is enabling those 7 million deaths per year? Guess who? Governments, who are subsidizing fossil fuels. So in the conversation in the media, when you hear about solar and wind and so on, you hear or read, oh, but they're subsidized. But guess what? According to the World Bank, about $557 billion go from governments to subsidize consumption of fossil fuels. That $500 billion, right? For what? For the right to kill all these people, for the right to cause climate change. And in India, subsidies amount to about $40 billion. So these are subsidies to fossil fuel consumption. And that's on top of the damage caused by indoor and outdoor air pollution. So this is just a, you know, a big idea to talk about the centrality. And I could go on and talk about the geopolitical aspects and the war aspects and so on and so forth. But that's not what I want to do. I just wanted to, you know, introduce you to the idea that energy is huge. It's $8 trillion, and it touches every single aspect of our lives. Is it a crisis? Yeah, it's a crisis. I'm already depressed. But are we ready for a disruption? Are we ready for a clean disruption? I certainly am. So I want to go back to New York City, 1900 to 1913. And at that time, we had a major disruption that took only 13 years. Are we ready for that kind of a disruption? Well, I'll come back to that, but I want to get back to why do experts not get it, right? So I want to tell you about one of my favorite cases, 1985. The then largest telecom company in the world, AT&T, had basically invented many of the key technologies for cell phones, for this thing called the cell phone, which at the time was 1 kilo and so on. And they hired management consulting company McKinsey, and they asked them one question. In 15 years, how many cell phone subscribers will we have in the United States? So give me a 15-year projection. And you know, McKinsey did its thing, and whatever it is that they do, and they came back with the answer, 900,000. So McKinsey thought, you know, the smartest kids in, you know, at the smartest business schools thought that in 15 years, there would be 900,000 cell phone subscribers. The reality was, in the year 2000, 109 million. This is not a small mistake, right? I mean, this is a factor of 120 times. My little dog could do better, right, than McKinsey did. So you wonder, you know, why they make these mistakes that are 100 times reality. But, you know, to the point of disruption, AT&T, which had built the largest landline telephony business in the world, got disrupted. But also, by not getting into the disrupting technology, which they already had, cell phones, if you look on the right at the top 15 publicly listed companies in 2015, that's a valuation of $2.4 trillion. So not only did AT&T get disrupted, but also they missed out on some of the biggest opportunities, multi-trillion dollar opportunities of the 21st century. And basically that's what happens when essentially smart people and smart organizations fail to lead market disruptions. So why don't they do it? I mean, you know, if I get it, why don't they get it? What we've had over the last few years is a whole lot of disruptions in many markets that haven't been explained even by the disruption experts. The GPS disruption, for instance. Does anyone remember Garmin? Gone, right? And it happened just like this. That was not explained by experts. And the disruption of smartphones. When the smartphone came out, folks said, who would buy a $600 smartphone when you have the $100 Nokia? Remember Nokia? Gone, right? So that's what I call a disruption from above, and that concept did not exist a few years ago. So essentially, I came back to the drawing board to build a new model for disruption that we could use to explain, but also to anticipate. And so I'm going to walk you through one of the most important parts of my model, which is technology cost curves. And technology cost curves, if you can follow them and anticipate, they can help you anticipate. So one of the most important, so I live in San Francisco, and basically it's Silicon Valley. What built Silicon Valley is Moore's Law. Basically, all of Silicon Valley depends on Moore's Law, or has been built on Moore's Law. What does it say? It says this: computing power, essentially the cost of computing power, goes down by a half every 2 years. So basically it improves by 41% every year. Now, when you double, so the other way to look at it is you double computing power for the same dollar every 2 years. When you double something every 2 years, it pretty much, pretty soon, it gets to be a really large number. So over 20 years, it gets to be a 1,000 time improvement. Over 40 years, it's 1 million time improvement. And basically, Silicon Valley has been around for about 50 plus years. It's been a 1 billion time improvement. And that's essentially why it's disrupted so many other industries. But Moore's Law is not the only technology, important exponential technology or technology cost curve that has disrupted industries. So over the last couple of decades, several technologies have improved at exponential rates. Data storage, digital imaging, network capacity, and so on and so forth. And what happens is this: when these technologies converge at a certain point, they enable the creation of what I said, disruptive products and services like the smartphone, like the iPhone, like the... So if you think about when the smartphone came out, so does anyone remember life before this? When did the smartphone come out? 2007, right? And both Apple and Google came out with smartphones the same year. Was that a coincidence? It wasn't, because 2007 was the year where the convergence of all of these technologies made it possible for someone to come up with something like a smartphone. And those someones happened to be Google and Apple, but it could have been somebody else. So 2007 was the year of the convergence of those technologies. And I'll come back to why that convergence is important for energy and transport. Now, let's not confuse technologies with markets. So it's important to remember that the technology cost curves go down and so on, but they don't always enable markets to grow exponentially. So exponential markets are basically markets that grow exponentially. And this is an interesting statistic that I dug up in 93 when I was at Cisco, a little company. I was employee number 400 or so at Cisco Systems. And when I was hired, basically the CEO told me, I have good news and bad news. Basically, the good news is we're growing super like crazy. The bad news is we don't know why, right? I mean, what's causing this growth? So it's your job to figure out what is causing all of this growth. And so I started digging for all kinds of information, and I found this very interesting statistic. The number of internet hosts, which was growing at about 10x every 3 years or so. And it really didn't take an MIT degree to... if you took those numbers and out to the year 2010, you would say, you know, we're going to have a billion internet hosts in 2010. And of course, that's what I said. And what did you think people told me, even within Cisco? What are you smoking? Right? And can I have some? I mean, how... a billion internet hosts, what on earth are we going to use that for? Like, who needs a billion internet hosts? And guess what? We're on our way. Not only did we make it, but we're on our way to a trillion. And that's going to be caused by sensors. But that's another conversation. So Right now, and for the last few years, I've been following these technologies, which I think, and some of my colleagues think, when you combine in different ways, you can essentially anticipate disruptions in every single large industry in the world. So if you combine these technologies in different ways, you could anticipate how healthcare is going to be disrupted, or finance is going to be disrupted, or manufacturing and so on. So I took this model and these technologies, and what I did was think about how they could disrupt energy and transportation. And another part of that model, of course, is product innovation, which is huge. When that convergence happens, those who innovate and come up with the most interesting ways to combine those technologies are the winners, and they change everything. So, you know, which companies have caused interesting disruptions within their market segments? This is a company called Nest, which created a very simple thermostat with artificial intelligence and communication, $200 thermostat. Thermostats are pretty stupid. I mean, even programmable thermostats, you know, I have a computer science degree. I can't program programmable thermostats. I just can't do it. So what they created was a thermostat that learns from the user. So they have sensors that know when you're home. They learn when you get home, what time, and they adjust the temperature 20 minutes or so before you get home. And then when you leave for work, then they adjust the temperature back, and that way they save, 40%, 30% of energy. Very simple, for $200. So it's this kind of product innovation that can basically change industries. Another interesting product is this one, trash can. Who would have thought? I mean, waste management, right? We've used trash cans for millennia, right? So suddenly this company came up with a smart trash can. What on earth is a smart trash can? Well, essentially it's one that today, when in waste management, trucks go around picking up trash cans. They don't know which ones are empty, which ones are full. They just don't. They just go around and pick up trash cans. This one, which is very wasteful. So the waste management industry is very wasteful. Sorry, I mean, I couldn't resist. This one, well, A, it's powered by solar. So essentially, you don't need to connect it to the grid. It's connected. It has a little motor that compacts the trash. But also, the most important thing, it sends a message back home saying, back to headquarters, saying, I'm full, or I'm about to be full, come pick me up. And just that little knowledge helps companies, waste management companies, save 80% of essentially costs in collecting the garbage, right? So that's what a smart trash can does. And so this is the type of product innovation that can change whole industries, even trash cans. So let's put it all together. So I put this together and applied it to, guess what, energy and transportation, and I came up with this book, Clean Disruption of Energy and Transport, which says this. There are four key technologies or technology categories, batteries, electric vehicles, self-driving / car sharing, and solar, that each one of them is disruptive, but together they enable one another and they accelerate one another, and together they will wipe out, they will essentially change all of energy and transportation as we know it, and it's going to happen over the next 14 years, and I'm going to show you how. So let me start with energy storage, batteries. And I'm going to use the example of lithium-ion batteries. So lithium-ion batteries is what you have in your cell phone or laptop. Since 1995 to about 2010, the cost of lithium-ion batteries improved by about 14% per year, 14%. Around about 2009, two new industries came into the lithium-ion industry, energy and transportation, automotive, right? And because of the increase in R&D and investment and market and so on, what that did was accelerate that 14% cost curve to 16%. And in fact, if we look over the next 4 years, and if we look at the last 18 months or so, it's accelerating even more. But let's keep to that 16%, because what I want to show you is how to think in terms of anticipating disruptions and how quickly they can happen. So if we take that 16% cost curve for batteries, then we can see over the next few 3, 7, 15 years, what the cost of 1 kilowatt hour of lithium-ion battery is gonna be over the next to 2030. 300, 200, 100. And I'll show you, this assumes, of course, that this technology will improve at that rate. And of course, we have to do our homework to get there. So will it improve at 16%? So what is happening right now is the biggest investment boom in batteries ever in history. And it's happening pretty much everywhere. That we know, there are 12 plus mega factories being built right now. Those are, you know, $1 billion plus factories that are being built right now that are gonna open up before 2020. When Tesla announced its gigafactory 2 or 3 years ago, they were gonna double world production of lithium ion. People told them they were nuts. You know, they're gonna build a factory that is gonna remain empty because there was gonna be no market. And Tesla is taking that and it's tripling its capacity. But it's not just them, it's BYD, it's LG, it's Samsung SDI. It's a whole bunch of companies. Now Total, an oil company, acquired the battery company. So oil companies are getting into batteries also. You may see Dyson, right? Vacuum cleaners. They're getting into the battery business. They're investing £1 billion, British pounds, in batteries, right? Dyson, why would they want to do that? So the point is that investments in batteries are increasing exponentially. And because of this, the technology, the 16% cost curve is actually accelerating and accelerating massively. So the things that I'm gonna talk about now are gonna happen even more quickly because of this acceleration. Okay, I mentioned that Dyson was investing £1 billion, right? They were getting into the electric vehicle market. Dyson is getting into the electric vehicle market, okay? Why would, you know, basically a vacuum cleaner company get into the EV market? Answer, because they can, right? This is the moment when you can invest and get into these markets because we're on the cusp of disruption. But of course, you know, talk about a clean disruption, you know, Dyson could not resist that. Now, another thing about disruption is that business model innovation is every bit as disruptive as technology innovation. So when we think innovation, we think technology, but in fact, if you think of Uber, Ola, and so on, they are business model innovations. They're not really technology innovations. You know, they took basically a massive infrastructure, the cloud, another massive infrastructure, the smartphone, and they put it together in intermediating basically inefficient markets. So these are business model innovations, and as we know, they can be very disruptive. So what kind of business model innovations are interesting in storage? Well, this is one. Quite a few Silicon Valley companies are doing what's called storage as a service. So you go to a 7-Eleven or to a hotel and so on, and you say, Today, half of your electricity bill comes from essentially spikes in energy demand when people come in and they open the fridge, right? And if you take a battery and put it behind the meter, essentially you filter out those spikes. You use the same energy, but the utility doesn't see the spikes, and therefore you don't pay the higher energy cost, and you save 40, 50%. And I'm so sure that that's going to happen that I won't charge you anything for the battery. I'll just share 50-50, whatever you save. Isn't that interesting? And some of these companies are going like crazy because they are saving a lot of money, you know, the 7-Elevens and so on. So again, business model innovation is very disruptive. And there are a lot of numbers in this slide, but this shows how if you take this business model to its logical conclusion, which is when our apartments and homes and so on essentially can afford batteries to save this kind of money that businesses are saving, essentially we're gonna have batteries in every home. Why? Because essentially Americans consume almost, you know, more electricity than anyone else in the world on a per capita basis. I think we consume about 10 times more than India does on a per capita basis. So, but by 2020, when the retail cost of batteries is about $200 per kilowatt hour, it's gonna cost about $1 a day to store a full day of electricity in the United States. Now, we consume 10 times more than Indians, so it's gonna cost 10 cents a day for the average Indian home to store 24 hours of electricity. What does that do? Well, essentially, you take away the pricing power of the utility, you know, in the peaks, essentially in the summer peaks and so on. You take that away when you can store electricity when prices are low, and you use it when prices are high. And it's gonna cost 10 cents per day as soon as 2020. I mean, that's only 3 years away. I mean, it's November, right? Another aspect of the industry that's gonna be disrupted by batteries is essentially peakers. So those of you in energy, peakers are what we use in the summers, the summer heat, essentially because the electricity grid is an on-demand system without storage. And because we don't have storage, in the summer, when demand goes up, we switch on peakers. Demand goes up, we switch on peakers, and so on and so forth. So peakers are only used about 6% of the time. Now, a 6% asset utilization is a disruption waiting to happen. And what's gonna cause that disruption is storage. So if you can store energy when it's cheap on the grid, I'm talking about big batteries here, essentially you take away the need for peakers, which are used only 10, 100, 200 hours per year. And even conventional energy CEOs are saying right now that there may never be another peaker again after 2020. 2020, again, that year. 2020 is popping up more and more and more. So if you're an investor, think about who makes peakers and what do they run on, right? Natural gas, hint, hint. So these are basically different markets that will be disrupted by batteries. And when batteries go down in cost the way that they will go, essentially every home, every business, every parking lot, every building is gonna have batteries, just like we all have batteries in our laptops and our smartphones and so on. And because these batteries are gonna be connected, think of them as an internet of batteries, where basically they can exchange energy and information and so on, and that's gonna change everything about the paradigm of energy that we've been using for the last 100 years. Now, another thing that battery costs coming down the way they're coming down, they're gonna enable another major disruption, which is the electric vehicle disruption, or I should say the oil, petroleum disruption. So let me use Tesla as an example. as a case study of electric vehicles. And I guess I don't need to say more about Tesla other than, it's the best car ever made, according to many in the industry, according to Consumer Reports. It's the best car, not the electric vehicle. It's the best car ever made. Consumer Reports, which is an independent organization, gave it a rating of 103 out of 100. Does it sound like a movie? You know, it's 7, right? It's not 10. So it's that good. And it's already the best-selling luxury car in America and in some markets in Europe. A car company that did not exist 10 years ago is outselling Audi, Mercedes, BMW, and so on, right? That's what a disruption looks like. But here's the question. Who can afford an electric vehicle? Not me. That's just a photo op. It's not, I don't actually own a car. I don't own a car at all. And I'll come back to why that is the case. I'm on to the next disruption. But here's the question. Is the electric vehicle disruptive? And we need to answer that. Because in the mind of a lot of people, the electric vehicle is just a substitute for the ICE, the internal combustion engine automobile. And that is the same thought that led folks to believe that this was not disruptive. Meaning, we can make phone calls using smartphones, like we could with a Nokia, but making phone calls is just one of a thousand things that we can do with this. And that's partly why this is so disruptive, and Nokia does not exist as a telecom company anyway, right? So is the electric vehicle disruptive the way that smartphones are disruptive? So I'll walk you through the thought process just to show you why. Number one, the electric drivetrain, the electric motor, is 5 times more energy efficient than the internal combustion engine. So your car, assuming you don't have an EV, only turns about 17 to 21% of the gasoline in the tank into our power. The rest literally goes up in smoke. Whereas an EV turns about 95% of the energy in the battery into usable power, 5x. Now, that in and of itself is not disruptive, but when you combine it with the fact that electricity, electrons, are easier to transmit and cheaper than atoms, meaning gasoline and diesel, what you get is that once you buy the electric vehicle, it's 10 times cheaper to charge on a per kilometer basis than the gasoline vehicle, 10 times. Now, every time we have a 10x in an important dimension, we have a potentially disruptive product. And that is the case with EVs. 10 times cheaper to charge than your cars. Now, this is another reason, maintenance. This is your car, I mean, not literally your car, but this is a gasoline car. It has 2,000 plus moving parts, not just parts, moving parts. The electric vehicle has, does anyone know? Huh? Yeah, about 20 moving parts. From 2,000 to 20, that's a 100 time advantage, 20 moving parts. That's why EVs don't break down. And of course, they don't need the kind of maintenance that is the lifeline of the ICE car industry. And that's why companies like Tesla offer infinite mile warranty. Infinite. You can drive this thing to the moon and back, and for 8 years, they're going to warranty the car. Why? Because they can. 20 moving parts, they're not going to break. Electric motors literally last forever. I mean, almost. Here's another reason. EVs are way more powerful than internal combustion engine automobiles. A lot more. If you have not driven an EV, I encourage you, please do it. Now, this is an example of a student team, university students in Switzerland, built an EV that beat the $1 million Porsche Spyder, basically in acceleration by a long margin. Students, we're not talking about Tesla here, right? You know, this is a bunch of students who beat the $1 million Porsche. So that gives you an idea as to why the EV is disruptive. And, you know, I can give you many more reasons, but basically you have something that is, this is what the industry has shown us essentially for about a century. Essentially, for about a century, every time we go buy a car, if we want high performance, then we have to pay high dollars. If we want medium performance, then we pay medium money. If we want low performance, you know, three-wheelers and whatnot, then we pay low money. What the EV industry is doing, and it's gonna do, is essentially shift that curve to a point where the ICE industry is not gonna be able to compete. And that's where we're gonna have the, you know, before and the after, the horses and the cars, when that happens. So the question is, when is that gonna happen? When is that curve going to shift to the point where internal combustion engine automobiles are not competitive anymore, like those pictures? So how do we think about this? Let's go back to the cost curve. The main cost item of EVs is what? Batteries. So they're about a third of the total cost of an EV. So if we take the battery, that 16% cost curve, remember, and we apply it to electric vehicles with all the other parts, and we extend it out over the next 15 years, this is what we get. And you can do this cost curve for any market, essentially. So if I do it for the US, this is what I get. If we start with Tesla in 2014, the Model S, at $75,000, and we go down about 60%, essentially this is what we get. By about 2017 or 18, the industry, not just Tesla, the industry will be able to build a $35,000 to $40,000 electric vehicle. Now, 200 miles, 320 kilometers is the minimum that the industry is gonna need to go mainstream. So that's essentially what consumers have said. So we do the numbers for the 320 kilometer EV. 35 to 40,000 by 2017 or 18. By 2020, it's gonna be the $30,000 EV. Now, 2020, it's that number again. Now, why is this important? Because the median new ICE car in America is $33,000. By 2020, if this curve is right, the industry will build $30,000 EVs, which is 10% cheaper than the equivalent ICE car, and also 10 times cheaper to charge on a per kilometer basis, 100 times cheaper to maintain over the lifetime, and so on and so, and also more powerful, right? And that's gonna happen by 2020. So essentially, the median car, 50% of the market, is gonna be disrupted by about 2020. By 2022 or three, the low end in America, which is about 20,000, gone. By 2025, essentially, with this cost curve, it says every new vehicle will be electric by 2025. Essentially, ICE cars won't be able to compete by 2025 at any cost. So the price of oil is gonna be irrelevant at that point, essentially because, you know, charging is gonna be 10 times cheaper for electric vehicles. And that's gonna happen, not even 2030, that's gonna happen by 2025. And that's what the cost curve says. So what does the market say? Well, GM announced the $37,500 Bolt, which is already being made, and it's gonna be made, basically they're gonna make in the tens of thousands next year. 37,500, so that's smack in the middle of my cost curve. Tesla announced the $35,000 Model 3, which, by the way, has more performance than a Porsche. So here's your $35,000 electric vehicle with 340 kilometer range, more power than the Porsche, okay? And when is it coming out? 2017, 2018, just like the cost curve said. And does the market care? Well, Tesla sold, or pre-sold, 180,000 cars the day that they announced it. 180,000 people gave $1,000 each just to reserve this car. And that gives you an idea of the latent demand for a car with this performance at this price. Okay? Now, that is $6.3 billion, which if Tesla actually does build and sell these cars, will have been the biggest sales event day of any product of any kind in history. So that gives you an idea of how disruptive this car can be. And for the bankers in the audience, over the following 2 weeks, Tesla sold or pre-sold 400,000 cars, which means that they raised $400 million without hiring an investment bank, right? I mean, the biggest crowdfunding event in history, right? And that is, you know, the topic for another disruption. But in any case, so it's not just Tesla. A whole number of companies are building now EVs. And so Foxconn, for instance, the company that makes iPhones and iPads and so on, has announced that they're entering the EV market. Again, we have computer companies, Apple, Uber, Google, Foxconn, who are announcing or are basically making EVs of some sort or another. And in China, right now, there are 200 plus companies that are making electric vehicles. 200, not two, not 20, 200, right? Disruptions usually happen from outside. So, you know, it's not the Fords and the GMs and so on who are gonna cause the disruption. It's gonna be, if history is any indication, companies from outside. Now, business model innovation, like I said, is very disruptive. How does that apply to EVs? Because, you know, we really don't have a charging network, right? How are we gonna have EVs without chargers? Now, 90% of EV owners charge at home, which in and of itself is disruptive. But Renault in Europe announced this new company called Airbnb. So you know Airbnb, the same concept for electricity. So what Airbnb does, it enables anybody, any home, any business, anybody to offer themselves as a charging station. You don't even need to put up an infrastructure. Essentially, you know, you can plug it in, you rent by the hour, you rent by the, you know, minute or whatever, and any car can use any home, and that essentially is a business model innovation, right? And it's happening right now, and it's brought to you by Renault. Another thing, another business model innovation, is free charging. Think about that, right? There's this company in San Francisco called Volta that is essentially going to supermarkets, and they're saying, if you allow me to put my chargers in front of your store, you can offer your clients, your customers, free charging while they shop in your store, right? It doesn't cost you anything. Basically, you attract EV, that audience, and essentially, we charge it for free. How do they make money? Advertising. How does Google make money? Advertising, right? And this company is growing, you know, again, exponentially because of a business model innovation. And so another thing that can accelerate all of these disruptions, the EV disruption, is the fact that, as I said, the EV is not a substitute, just a substitute for the ICE vehicle. You can use your electric vehicle to power your house. And in fact, this product already exists. Nissan built it. You can charge, a lot of people charge at work. They come back home and they use this system, and you can actually power your home with your car. Think about that. How disruptive is that? So it's disruptive because you don't need the grid anymore. You can charge anywhere and you can basically power your house. And in fact, if I did the numbers for India, and if every passenger car, right, four-wheeler, in India were electric, essentially cars, EVs, could store 37% of the daily electricity demand in the whole country, and EVs. So EVs are not just mobility, they're power plants on wheel, right? It's a moving battery of sort. And if you can make money doing this, then all the power to you. Now, I said by 2025, every new vehicle will be electric. That's a big disruption. An even bigger disruption is the autonomous vehicle disruption, better known as self-driving cars. Now, let me walk you through how disruptive self-driving is going to be, or very soon.
Right here in America, we're introducing the world's first truck with an AV license plate. The first autonomous truck on public roads ever, anywhere in the world.
Germany's Daimler rolled out the inspiration Tuesday night. It has been granted a license for road use in the state of Nevada. The license allows the inspiration to be tested on Nevada's freeways and highways. Nevada is one of four states and the District of Columbia that allow autonomous vehicle testing on public roads. A Daimler spokesperson said they opted for Nevada because they had strong and clear regulations for acquiring the road license.
Self-driving trucks. Now that comes from Daimler. And when that came out about a year and a half ago, it shocked the world. We already have self-driving trucks on the road. Today, there are 33 corporations working on self-driving cars. 33. And these are not startup companies. These are, you see the names, very, very large companies. Self-driving is not a thing of the future. It's happening as we speak. And basically, a lot of people are investing in this. In fact, if you go to Singapore, you can actually get into a self-driving taxi today. Well, not today, but you know, if you go to Singapore. It's already happening. And I went to visit about 3 months ago the lab where this car was built. It's a joint MIT-Singapore research lab. And it's already happening. I mean, this is not a thing of the future. And every large OEM, like I showed, is already announcing when they're going to come out with self-driving cars. Now, when I say self-driving, I mean level four, which means no steering wheels, no pedal, nothing. No humans needed at all. This thing is a computer, basically, on wheels. And Nissan is saying by 2020 or so, 2018, Tesla is saying that the next model, the Model 3, is going to be fully self-driven. You know, essentially, you can call your car from New York to San Francisco, say, and say, just come, and it'll come, right? I mean, that's a year away. I mean, we're not talking about, you know, I mean, it's already there. And by the way, while you're at it, when you're here, play Beyonce, because that's the music I like. So they're smart that way. So it's happening already. The question is, or a question is, what about the cost? Because if you read the media, what you're going to hear is they're very expensive. So let me show you two technologies that are key to making self-driving cars and basically trucks and buses and everything possible. So this is what a self-driving car sees when it uses a sensor called LiDAR. So LiDAR is short for laser and radar. A LiDAR emits about 1 million laser pulses per second, 200 meters away, 360 degrees, which bounce back like a radar. And then you have a supercomputer in the trunk that essentially puts together all those signals and makes up this view of the world. 1 million laser pulses per second. So real time, the car knows whether this is a tree, whether, you know, it's a moving cat or whatever. The CEO of, so I'll tell you about this story. So in 2012, when Google announced the costs of its autonomous car, they said just the LiDAR was $70,000. And of course, what did the experts say? Not gonna happen. Not in this generation, maybe not in the next generation, right? Too expensive. What did happen was that the next generation LiDAR, the following year, was $10,000. $10,000, just 1 year later. And 1 year after that, the CEO of this Silicon Valley company called Quantergy spoke in my class and said, we're building a $1,000 LiDAR. Within 2 or 3 years, essentially LiDAR went from $70,000 to $1,000. But wait, there's more, as they would say. That same company announced a $250 LiDAR last year, in January of this year. $250, and it's solid state, which is basically better than the moving LiDAR. So one of the essential technologies for self-driving, which is LiDAR, has gone from 70 grand to 250, essentially within 4 or 5 years. Boom. I mean, that's what technology cost curves do. So the other technology is computing. I mentioned that you need a supercomputer in your car or somewhere to basically read all of these signals and then crunch them and convert them into, you know, stuff, that information that it can use to drive the car. Now, what is the cost of supercomputing? Just to give you an idea, in the year 2000, this was the world's most powerful supercomputer. That was a 1 teraflops, 1 trillion floating point operations per second, and it cost about $50 million. That was 2000. Last year, a company called NVIDIA announced a 2.3 teraflops, so twice the teraflops, for $50. Should I say that again? Right? From $50 million to $50, essentially in 16 years. Boom. That's basically, those are the cost curves that cause disruptions. And in fact, it's not just $50. It includes the software called deep learning, the artificial intelligence operating system, so that essentially anybody, you know, any engineering student can now build a self-driving car if they know how to program this NVIDIA GPU, right? Take that, Daimler. You don't need to invest $1 billion anymore. So essentially, that has already happened. There's an engineer in San Francisco who, with spare parts bought from Alibaba and Amazon and eBay, $50,000 investment, built his own self-driving car with a $50,000 investment. And essentially, he started a company with that. And what he wants to do is to sell $1,000 kits so that people can retrofit their cars and make them self-driving. $1,000. And the cost curve, as you see, is still going down. So, you know, what's the incremental cost? Not much. So cost is not an issue. Is anything else an issue? Are consumers, are you ready for a self-driving car? A lot of people, you know, this is an experience good. You have to actually experience it before you answer. But in a lot of countries, interestingly, India is one of them, folks are saying, bring it on right now. China, India, Brazil. In Brazil, 95% of consumers are saying, bring it on right now. Not only that, they're also saying, I will put my kids into a self-driving car right now. Okay, so some markets, about half of the world's population, are ready for self-driving. Why? Well, this is my hypothesis. This is why. Okay, so being in Mumbai, I can see how, you know, this can make you want to be in a self-driving car. But I still haven't told you if this is disruptive and how this is disruptive. Because, sure, you can trade stocks, you can tweet, you can Facebook, you can Instagram while you not drive, but how is that disruptive? So here's the disruption. The disruption is not just the technology. It's when you combine the self-driving car technology with a business model innovation. But before I tell you, I want to show you this number. We spend a lot of money buying a car. This is why I don't own a car. Because, you know, we spend all that money in a car and we keep it parked 96% of the time, right? You know, financially, it makes no sense. I mean, you know, 4% asset utilization, again, is a disruption waiting to happen. So, you know, how is that disruption going to happen? I'll show you. It's when you converge car sharing with self-driving. So Uber already is testing its own self-driving cars in Pittsburgh already. Again, this is not in the future. It's already happening. And so when you combine basically self-driving with Uber, the money that they give drivers, they don't want to give anything. They want to keep it all to themselves, right? I don't know. In any case, but it's not just Uber. It's also GM. I mean, GM invested $500 million in Uber's competitor called Lyft. They invested $1 billion in a self-driving car company. And also, I told you about the GM Bolt electric vehicle. So electric, self-driving, and car sharing, right? And they're already starting to do pilots of that combination. And what they say is that the car will be driving 60 to 70% of the time. So think about that. We use cars only 4% of the time. What happens if we start using them 60 to 70% of the time? They become 15 times cheaper on a per kilometer basis. Does that make sense? Or at least 10 times cheaper. So again, a 10x difference in cost is a potential disruption waiting to happen. And so when you combine this, this is what's essentially, so I talked about Uber. What happens is when you go from 4% to, take your pick, 60, 70, 80% asset utilization, the cost per mile goes down by about 10 to 20 times. So on average in the US, the cost of car ownership is about $1 a mile. And that's going to go down to about 5 cents. So it's going to go down dramatically. So take whatever number of car ownership, you know, there is in that particular market and divide it by 10 or 20. That's going to be the cost per kilometer of not owning a car. Now, in America, we spend about $12,000 a year owning a car, right? $12,000 on average. If somebody like Uber, Ola, Lyft offers us basically the same level of service to take us from home to work, from work to the supermarket, from the supermarket to home or the bar or whatever, for a tenth of that cost, how many people do you think are not going to take the $11,000 per year in savings? Not going to happen, right? Every time there's that 10x improvement, the market will shift. I've never seen a market where the cost per the same service goes down by 10x and the market is not disrupted. So that's what's gonna happen in the automotive industry. So the concept of car ownership is gonna go away because the cost of not owning a car is gonna be so much cheaper. And that's already starting to happen. And that's why I don't own a car. And what else is going to happen when we start not parking our cars, but the cars are going to be driving all the time? Parking itself is going to be obsolete because self-driving cars don't need to park, right? They're going to be going round and round and round all day. And when they need to charge at night, they're not going to park downtown, right? They're not going to park in the financial district. They're going to go out somewhere to the, you know, industrial neighborhoods and basically where the cost of real estate is not that high, like here, And so all of these parking spaces and all of these garages, gone, right? Empty. They're not going to be needed. So 80% of parking is going to be obsolete. And how soon is this going to happen? By 2030, essentially. When you do the numbers, this disruption, it may happen actually before. I've done some scenario planning, and it says it's going to happen before that. But by 2030, essentially, this is what's going to happen. Parking is going to be obsolete. Essentially, car ownership is going to be obsolete. What else is going to be disrupted when car ownership is obsolete? What about car insurance? Gone, right? So because they're electric, then it's going to be oil. Gone, right? So if you start thinking about all of these adjacencies, all of these industries that are going to be disrupted, it's not just transportation. It's not just energy. But here's the question. Does this make sense for India, right? The self-driving plus car sharing and whatever. Well, we already have Ola competing head-to-head with Uber. So that's already happening. Does it make sense? Here's what happened in India. India never built a landline telephony infrastructure, right? India went straight from 5 million phones, landline, to 1 billion cell phones. It actually never built the infrastructure that took AT&T 100 years to build. And that's called leapfrog. So essentially what India did was leapfrogged to the next thing, which was mobile phones, which made sense because it was so much cheaper. It could be done without an infrastructure, landline infrastructure. The same thing applies to transportation. So does it make sense for India to build all the highways and all the roads and all the, you know, the multi-trillion dollar investment that you need to have 100 million, 200 million cars? The answer is no. And it makes sense for India to leapfrog to this model where everything is electric, self-driving, and shared, and cheap, right? So when you have something that is on demand and really, really cheap, what's going to happen is that this new mode of transportation, which is called mobility as a service, and so on, can give access to transportation to every demographics. Just like everyone has a cell phone today, and you know, before it was just 5 million people in India, very, very inexpensive mobility on demand essentially gives access to transportation to the very poor, to the elderly, to the very young who can't drive today, to the sick, to the disabled. So all kinds of demographics that don't have access to mobility today will have access to mobility when it's, you know, point to point and 10 to 20 times cheaper. And this makes sense for India more than it makes sense for advanced economies, Europe, the US, because we already have an infrastructure, right? So if you can leapfrog building that infrastructure, just like India leapfrogged the landline telephony, then it makes sense for India, you know, especially because it's gonna cost 10 to 20 times less. So when you look at the three dimensions of the disruption in transportation, different markets are gonna go at different speeds, car sharing, so from basically ownership to sharing, from ICE to electric vehicles, and from human to computer driven. You know, these are three dimensions and different markets are gonna go at different speeds. But essentially by 2030, every car out there, every bus, every tractor, everything that moves on four or three or even two wheels is gonna be electric, self-driven, and shared because it makes economic sense, right? And that's gonna be a huge disruption to car companies, to, like I said, insurance companies, petroleum, and so on and so forth. Now, the fourth disruption that I'm gonna talk about today, clean disruption, is solar. Now, remember one thing, everything that I'm talking about is technology, right? Not resources, everything that I'm talking about is technology. In solar, PV, photovoltaics, is a technology. Just like, you know, computer chips and so on. And solar PV has gone from $100 a watt in 1970 to 40 cents today. Actually, it's a little less than 40 cents, which means it's gone down 250 times in cost since 1970. Now, what about other sources of energy? Well, also at the same time, solar has grown exponentially. So you have a cost curve that's coming down exponentially that's driving a market that's growing exponentially. Now, solar has doubled every 2 years since the year 2000, actually since 1990. Doubled every 2 years. What happens when you double every 2 years? So today, solar is about 1.5% of energy generation. Let's double it. I mean, just bear with me for a second. We can do anything in a spreadsheet, right? So let's do it mentally. How many more doublings if solar keeps growing at this rate? Let's do the exercise that I did at Cisco many years ago, and people thought I was smoking something, right? So let's double 1.5% and see how soon it'll be 100%. So one doubling, 3%. Two doublings, 6, 12, 24, 48, 96. Six doublings. That's 12 years, right? Oh my God, 12 years. Now, we can do anything in a spreadsheet. Let's see if that makes sense in reality, in the real world, right? Can solar continue to grow at 41%, which is the CAGR that solar has been at since the year 2000. So let's compare to conventional energy. Every single form of conventional energy has gone up by 6 to 16 times since 1970. Coal, oil, gas, nukes have gone up like 16x, right? Now, when you combine that, even at today's low cost, even with oil at 30, solar has improved by more than 2,000 times relative to petroleum. 2,000 times. Now, when do you start losing sleep if you're in that industry, or in the nuclear industry, or in the natural gas industry? At 3,000? At 4,000? At 5,000? Because guess what? Solar PV is a technology, and it's going to continue to go down in cost, not resources. Now, for decades, the mantra in the solar industry has been what's called grid parity, which means the cost of rooftop solar basically at or below the cost of electricity rates from the utility. Now, what's been happening is that, according to Deutsche Bank, solar PV will have reached grid parity in 80% of global markets by the end of next year. 2017, that's only 12 months away, right? 80% of global markets and most of the United States. Essentially, solar PV on the rooftop will have reached grid parity. And because of this, the rate of growth may actually go up. It may actually accelerate. And when you look at not just residential, but commercial, basically you get this. So let me go back here and show you a recent survey by PwC. They found that 69% of corporations are right now in the process of purchasing solar. 69% of corporations. Now, how do corporations make decisions? Right? Money. When it makes financial sense, they will invest. And it doesn't mean that they're going to invest right now, but if they're considering solar, it means that it is at the point where it makes sense today or it may make sense soon. And a lot of companies are actually making that jump right now. So if you look at Las Vegas, for instance, Mandalay Hotel recently built the largest rooftop solar power plant in America, and they actually want to get off the retail market. They actually said, I want to be in the wholesale market because I'm producing so much, and the rest I want to buy from wholesale. I don't want to buy from the electricity, from the utility. And this is the shape of things to come, not just residential, but also commercial. And because of all of this, solar, the rate of growth may actually accelerate because it's getting to be so cheap. And just a reminder, when you read the reports from, you know, the International Energy Agency and you know, a lot of these global kind of energy outfits, you see a linear growth of solar and wind and so on in batteries. There isn't a single technology in history, to my knowledge, that has grown linearly, okay? Technologies get adopted as an S-curve. So it may take a while before they hit that tipping point, but when they do, they actually accelerate like an S, and you know, they capture 80% of the market, and soon they, you know, basically start slowing and so on. The S-curve is what we need to pay attention to. It, you know, all of these experts and, you know, insiders who say linear, not gonna happen because technology does not get adopted that way. So what is the S-curve of solar? Each market is gonna be different. I mean, in America, we have 3,000 utilities. So each market is gonna be different. Chile, Australia, each market is gonna be different. So look at your market, and the tipping point is gonna happen when we hit what I call God parity. Now, this is not a religious term at all. I'll tell you what it is. When rooftop solar, whether it's commercial or industrial or residential, falls below, unsubsidized, falls below the cost of transmission, it means this. Even if you generate in your central power station, coal, hydro, it doesn't matter, nuclear, even if you can generate at zero, when you add the cost of transmission, it'll always be more expensive than rooftop solar. Does that make sense? But at least in the 1,000 or 2,000 hours of sunshine, it'll always be more expensive, okay? That's what I call God parity. Why? Because even if you bring the God particle from Switzerland, from CERN, and you generate at zero, which is impossible, you'll still not be able to compete with distributed rooftop solar. And that is the tipping point in the market. When every consumer in that market makes the selfish economic interest decision to buy solar, not because it's green, but because of the this green, right? At that point, essentially, that's the tipping point when solar is going to accelerate. Now, when is that gonna happen? It's already happening. In places like Australia, rooftop solar, unsubsidized, it's 7 cents, and the cost of the grid is 12 cents, and the cost of electricity is 23 cents. So in fact, today, rooftop solar in Australia is below the cost of transmission. So Australian utilities today are being disrupted as we speak. The residential solar market has a 20-25% market penetration today, right? This is not in the future. The only thing keeping Australia from going 100% is batteries, right? Batteries. And I showed that batteries are going down in cost at a faster rate than even solar is. So you'll soon have, by about 2020 to 2021, in essentially every large market in the world, the cost of solar plus storage is gonna be below the cost of transmission. And at that point, it's pretty much over for the existing model of central power generation. And solar on the rooftop is gonna eat everything, essentially, because it's gonna be the right economic decision for everybody with a rooftop. So every house, every building, everything with a rooftop, and soon everything with a window, but that's another conversation, is gonna have solar because it's gonna make economic sense for those folks to have solar. And that, like I said, is gonna happen, it's starting to happen in some markets, and it's gonna happen pretty much everywhere, including, you know, Denmark and Norway by about 2021. But of course, we're still gonna have data centers, right? We're still gonna have aluminum smelters and so on. So we have the need for utility scale power generation. That's not going to go away. So, you know, we're still going to need large scale generation. But first, let me dispel a myth. The myth is you need a lot of land to make solar happen. Okay, that's a big myth that, you know, the conventional energy industry has, you know, it keeps feeding us. And, you know, those of us who don't do the numbers then don't think about it much, believe it. Now, India, essentially I did the numbers for India, and a 2,100 square mile solar plant, now, you know, nobody's gonna build that plant, but essentially can generate all the energy that India needs, period, right? So if you build a 2,100, you know, square kilometer solar plant, essentially that's 0.07% of India's landmass. That can power the whole country, period, right? You want to increase it by twice, so that's gonna be 0.14% of India's landmass. That's not a lot. You wanna triple the output, and so on, right? Does that make sense? And you know, if you take the Thar Desert, less than 1% of just the Thar Desert could power the whole country, right? That's it, 1% of a desert. And solar is 5 to 10 times more land efficient than the best hydro resource. And that gives you an idea of the land usage needs. Now, what about cost? So that's the land. Here's the cost curve for solar power purchase agreements in the US. Now, solar is a global industry. So when I show you prices in the US or in Saudi Arabia or in Abu Dhabi, they should translate, all else being equal, to any country in the world, assuming that cost of capital is about the same. In the US in 2015, power purchase agreements for solar were 5 cents. This is unsubsidized, so I'm adding back the subsidy. Now, to give you an idea of what that means, solar or anything at 5.8 cents is the equivalent of oil at $10 a barrel, okay? So that's where solar is or was in 2015. Or natural gas at $5 per million BTU, which unless you frack and so on and you're Qatar or, you know, Pennsylvania, you're not gonna find natural gas at five. But guess what? Even 5 cents, that was last year. This year, Chile announced solar at 2.9 cents. Unsubsidized, 2.9 cents. Abu Dhabi announced, after the shock was done with, announced 2.4 cents. So that is oil at $5 a barrel, or gas at 2.5. That's it. Solar is already in the desert the cheapest form of power generation today. It's cheaper than coal, it's cheaper than gas, it's cheaper than oil. Today, we're not talking about the future, okay? And like I said, the cost of solar is going down, and so just like 2.4 is shocking people, it's gonna still keep, it's gonna go down even more. So whatever distributed solar doesn't eat, essentially utility scale solar is going to eat. And in northern countries, Norway and Denmark and Germany and so on, whenever the, you know, there is no sunshine at all for weeks or months at a time, then wind has also gone through you know, exponential cost curve of its own, and wind is gonna complement solar. Again, does this make sense for India? Does solar make sense for India? Same thing, right? Same idea as landline telephony. You know, India leapfrogged, that didn't need to build that expensive landline telephony infrastructure. Same thing applies with solar. Why? Because you don't need transmission. You just put it up on your rooftop and you're done, right? You know, those 500,000 villages that I mentioned at the beginning of my presentation, they can have power, electric power, right away with solar without building the transmission grid. Boom, it can happen right away. In fact, that 40 billion in subsidies that the Indian government is giving to the fossil fuel industry, if you take 40 billion a year, you could essentially build solar plus storage for 100 million Indians per year. So in 5 years, you would essentially, at an incremental cost of zero, because you're already, you know, spending that money subsidizing the wrong energy, you could essentially give power to 500 million Indians who have no power, no electric power today. So for that same reason, that you don't need to build an expensive transmission, you can leapfrog into the world of distributed energy, which is going to happen anyway. You might as well do it now before the rest of the world does. And so as a country, when I talk to policymakers, I say, look, this is going to happen whether you want it or not. This is a technology disruption. It's going to happen, you know, just like digital cameras disrupted film, and just like the web disrupted publishing. This is going to happen because the technology cost curve says so. Now, as a country, you have a choice. You can lead or you can follow. And if you lead, you can essentially start investing, and you can build the skills and the manufacturing capability and the software capability and so on to lead and export and create the jobs and so on and so forth that basically will lead in the 21st century. So those are the choices, disrupt or be disrupted, lead or follow. And what happens is when you have solar energy, which is going down to a cent per kilowatt hour, what you get is a lot of industries with high energy needs are going to move into those countries that start creating that cheap energy because it makes economic sense for those industries to be there. And even existing industry, like textile, for instance, which is huge in India, the cost of energy for textiles is a big component, and cheap energy can make a big difference in keeping those jobs and adding more jobs and basically increasing the profitability of those industries. Same thing can be said for mining and for other industries as data centers and so on, right? So when you build, when you leapfrog, when you bypass that whole fossil fuel and central generation model and get into the disruptive technologies, then not only do you get to build those industries, you get also to attract new industries. And as it happens, it's a once in a century opportunity to both do the right thing and also to make money from doing it. I mean, isn't that great? Isn't that a great opportunity? So let me wrap it up, right? Because I know that I'm standing between you and dinner. So let me take you back to the future in a way. It's 2016, and I started the presentation with these slides. And we're there. We're on the horse. Where is the car? We're at the, you know, a lot of these technologies are in the 1%, 2%, you know, self-driving is 0%, right? And a lot of folks, smart people and experts say, nah, not going to happen. But see, when you follow the cost curve and the business model disruption, then you can see how it's pretty inevitable that it is going to happen, and it's going to happen over the next 5 to 15 years. So these are the key technologies: batteries, electric vehicles, self-driving, and solar. These are the technologies that are going to wipe out the century, basically, of infrastructure in gasoline cars, and central generation power. And like I said, over the next 5 to 15 years, we're going to see more changes in both energy and transport than we have seen essentially in 100 years. And I'll close with this. This is not an energy transition. This is a technology disruption. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Seba. That was a very enlightening view into the future. Mr. Narayan, please, for the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Tony.
Thank you. Thank you. My pleasure.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for taking time out. I think in another forum, I heard about a law called Amara's Law. What it says? A-M-A-R-A. Amara's Law says many things in technology, we have a tendency to overestimate in short term and underestimate its impact over the long term. I think we grossly underestimate the impact coming from the technology-led disruption, partly in energy transportation, it's being evident, but it's likely to happen across the sectors, and which is why it gives me a feeling that 10 of these 50 Nifty companies won't even exist. So our idea is to be either, we have a choice, either we can disregard the whole proposition saying it's a hoax, all that, the environment, climate change, all the emissions, or you can recognize it and invest in a manner to benefit out of this change. I think that's where Unifi is coming from. And thank you again. Thank you so much for taking time out.